Ian and Joe, take a look at this.
Oh, well, that's some innocent people who, after a long struggle, have proved their innocence. Post-masters. There's someone who's not innocent. That's the former chief executive, Paula Fennell. She's guilty. There she is, humping mailbags. That'll be her next profession.
Sewing them.
So, it's a fantastic result. 39 people, one of the biggest miscarriages of justice this country's ever seen, have cleared their reputations. And they were locked up and their lives were ruined and their reputations were destroyed because the post office said, you're stealing at the end of the day from your machines. And they weren't. It was a classic. The computer had got it wrong. It was a faulty IT system. And for nearly 10 years, the post office continued to say, no, the computer says yes, you're guilty. It was that feeble.
Mm. And also people were told that they were the only people who had done this.
Yeah.
They weren't told that there was dozens or hundreds of other people.
And even thought somebody in the post office might have said, how is it that a disproportionate amount of dishonest people come and work for the post office? Because the company, the post office chief execs, were the only ones that knew how many there were. And you say 39, but there are a lot more cases still to come.
Yeah. Yes, no. I mean, it was 39 acquittals.
Yeah.
But the case action was about 500 odd.
But you should take a bow because Private Eye was the magazine for the last 10 years that's been pushing this story, haven't you? Been investigating it.
We have banged on about it quite a lot. But, Computer Weekly started it off and there was a good BBC programme called Inside Out South, which should take a bow. Yeah. So, and some brilliant, obviously, postmasters themselves saying, I don't think I should have been locked up. and why did no one believe us for this amount of time? This is useless government IT. The same firm, Fujitsu, did the NHS IT system, which lost £12 billion and had to be scrapped because it was entirely useless.
Did they do the Nando's app? Because that's terrible. Nightmare. Every time I go for lemon and herb, it gives me like extra spicy. I'm too delicate for it.
It doesn't arrest you afterwards, does it?
It probably gets close.
Yes, the Public Accounts Committee described their handling of the NHS patients' details as the worst contracting fiasco in the history of the public sector. That was before Test and Trace. Fujitsu, obviously, is the company. Horizon was the system.
Yeah.
When did Fujitsu become aware that the Horizon system they had developed was faulty?
10 years ago.
According to Computer Weekly, a senior software developer who worked at Fujitsu alleged that the system should never have been launched and that bosses at Fujitsu knew this. Everybody in the building, by the time I got there in 2001, knew it was a bag of shit. It had gone through the test labs God knows how many times, and the testers were raising bugs by the thousand. Mm. Paula Venels, there she is. She'd be quite good in Line of Duty, wouldn't she?
looks like a crypt keeper. She is.
She's the former chief executive of the post office. Paula's a very accomplished woman. She's not only an ordained Anglican vicar, she also became a non-executive director at the supermarket chain Morrison's and the furnishings retailer Dunelm, an advisor to the Cabinet Office and chair of Imperial College NHS Trust, as well as overseeing the most widespread miscarriage of justice in British legal history. So well done, Paula. why is Paula Venels taking all the blame for the post office fiasco?
It's her fault, I would say.
She was chief executive. Tim Parker was chairman.
Here he is, Tim Parker.
Oh, my God.
Oh.
Was it low clouds that day? What the earth is going on there? Well, we can see where the money's gone, can't we?
He looks as though he's borrowed the judge's wig. On his head. He said of this he'd like to apologise for historic failures, by which he was trying to imply things that had happened a long, long time
before he got there.
Before he got there, but it's just not true. You know, even a couple of years ago, the post office was trying to replace the judge who'd found the first lot of people innocent and saying he shouldn't be allowed to try the case anymore.
Why did they do this? I mean, presumably these people aren't evil, but what they did is so sort of incompetent and so dreadful. I mean, why couldn't they at the beginning of this say, look, it's been a terrible mistake? Why couldn't they admit to that?
It's partly due to, you're picking up an enormous bonus, but also it's just the basic thing I think of just believing in technology.
Yeah.
I know that sounds very, very archaic and stupid, but if you've got people saying, no, it really wasn't us stealing, you could listen to them.
That would be a good punishment, actually, for those execs, wouldn't it? A lifetime of the computer disagreeing with them. You know, they go into the hospital with a broken leg. Sorry, actually, the computer says it's not broken.
In fact, it's better.
It's better. Or a computer dating, setting them up with people who weren't very suitable. Yeah. For the rest of their life. Every night.
All this began at the turn of the century. Around that time, the Royal Mail had decided it was going to be called something else. Do you remember that was?
Bastards are us.
No. Remember, they decided they were going to be called Consignia.
Consignia, that's a sort of mafia post, isn't it?
That's number three.
Consigliere.
Oh, yes.
As the Royal Mail Chief Executive John Roberts explained, Consignia describes the full scope of what the post office does in a way that the words post and office cannot. It cost £1 million for that idea, and it was ditched only 2 years after, amid general agreement that it was the most unpopular brand in UK marketing history. But let's give credit, as you did earlier, Ian, to Computer Weekly magazine, which led the investigation into the post office story. Did you see how they described the predictability of government-backed IT projects ending in failure? It goes something like this. Ambitious project, outsourcing, bloat, disaster, crash, spend, spend, spend.
That's the weekend for me.
So, yes, this is the sub-postmaster scandal and calls for former post office chief Paula Venables to be stripped of her CBE. According to the Mail's brief biography of Paula Venables, until the post office catastrophe, her career, largely in retail, had been exemplary. Well, I'm guessing for many years, Harold Shipman was a top-notch GP. There was a solemn atmosphere in court as the judge read out the verdicts of the 39 sub-postmasters. Cashier number one, not guilty. Cashier number two, not guilty.
You know, maybe Rishi didn't have the only terrible launch.
Now, who might be particularly delighted with the timing of the election announcement?
Paula Venables from the post office. Because she was up in the inquiry and it blasted her off the front pages and she would have got an absolute shellacking.
That's right, former post office head honcho and national sweetheart, Paula Venables.
She cried four times for herself. It was a really disgraceful performance. And I think, yeah, it was appalling. She said things like, I didn't know that they were prosecuting these people in, you know, when I took over. And you think, that just isn't true. It's all lies. I mean, she is now in the inquiry trying to blame her colleagues, which is the entire point of the inquiry, is that she's already blamed people who didn't do it in an attempt to cover herself, and now she's doing it again.
I also just don't understand how you can come and take over an organisation where suddenly, out of nowhere, after a new computer system comes in, one in 12 people at work from you has got their hands in the till and you never previously noticed, even though they worked for you for 30 years before that.
And you work for the Tory party.
I know! Right?
But if what is happening is that the amount of money that you claim they've stolen is returned to the post office and then you take it out as a bonus, which they did, that's straightforward theft.
I was going to call it corruption.
That's worse than that.
Is it worse than corruption? Yeah. OK.
To just show some humility, what did Venables admit was a personal failure?
Oh, she said she was too trusting.
I was too trusting, she told the inquiry.
I mean, that's the Prince Andrew defence. I was too noble.
Yeah. I can't sweat, she said.
I use all my inner water for tears. And her tears reached number 10 Downing Street, didn't they?
Do you know what the inquiry chair, Sir Wynne Williams, asked her?
Did he say, why are you played by a different actor than in the TV show?
He wanted to know more about a briefing document Venables received which advised her to only provide certain information if really pushed to do so. Let's have a look.
If I were to suggest to you that you were being advised to be very precise, very circumspect, and very guarded about what you said. That was the effect of that document. Would you agree?
I would, Sir Wynne. I'm not sure I would have noticed that on the morning of the day.
But you'll see the point in a moment. That was the effect that was trying to be created by those who created that document.
It could have been, yes.
Right.
Yes.
Why?
Yeah. with hindsight, because possibly...
And if you need time to think about it,
no,
you can
I
tell
don't,
me...
No, no, I don't...
No, no, that's enough now.
Brutal.
Wow. If you need time, how about 10 years?
Is there any likelihood that the two will end up in prison, do you think?
I think as soon as the inquiry is over, the incoming government, be it Labour or Conservative...
Or Lib Dem.
Or Lib Dem.
Or Plaid Cymru.
Or Plaid Cymru. One of the ways we could make an early popular success is prosecute some of the people at the post office. I think it'd be a really good first week.
This is the news that Rishi Sunak's new job in Silicon Valley apparently starts on July 5th. The post office inquiry continues. When news of the post office scandal broke, Paula Venables also had a job with the NHS, now embroiled in the contaminated blood scandal. So she just needs a role with South West Water and she's got the set. While seemingly turning a blind eye to the wrongful convictions of sub-postmasters, Paula Venables also served as an Anglican vicar and could often be heard in church telling the famous parable of the screwing of the 5,000.
I love the use of the word seemingly. That was very good. Can we just check the lawyers awake?
What would you say, Ian?
Ignoring willfully through perverse and evil motivation. Well, the post office story is about miscarriage.
Mm-hmm.
900 people denied justice and persecuted for decades and not given any compensation, and now they're finally saying, oh, those people, yes, yes, we knew they were innocent. We just prosecuted them anyway. And the odd one out is that's an absolute national disgrace, and I don't care much about the others. Anyway, that...
Are you going to pick an odd one out, or...?
Yes. The Winslow boy.
Yes.
Mm. That was a miscarriage of justice.
Mm-hmm.
Stealing a postal order.
Exactly.
But he didn't do.
He didn't, but he was smoking, so he should have been shot.
Yeah.
Any guesses for what the odd one out is?
Yes, the aeroplane, the journalists, because they did it. They nicked stuff off the plane.
You're absolutely right. They have all been wrongly accused of stealing, apart from journalists on board Air Force One who have been asked to return stolen items. So before the post office inquiry resumed this week, what was the new evidence, Ian?
ITV had a tape,
mm-hmm.
people saying we had told Paula Venables
mm-hmm.
that Horizon could remotely access and fiddle their accounts. There was that, and then there was further evidence in the inquiry this week, and it is sort of getting there. It literally is everything that anyone has ever said for two decades is absolutely true.
Mm.
I was pleased to see that the BBC did give Private Eye a mention, because Private Eye did play a large part in writing about this story for 20-odd years. That's not enough reason to buy it. But, you know,
the mirror's not very gung-ho, are you?
It's all a load of nonsense, and it's Major trying to get some popularity at the last minute, and I don't think the British public will buy it. Feel me to be serious for a moment, which I doubt you do.
Well, it's good news for you, though. You've just discovered somebody who reads the Daily Mirror, because...
Thank you.
It's a more shocking discovery than that. I've just discovered Ian Hyslop can read.
Yeah. All the bitchings.
Yes. You wouldn't...
Because didn't you send
You should know all about complaints here.
But didn't you send photographers in to sneak up on this chap's wife while she was in a hospital or something caring like that?
Yeah.
And you got ticked off for that.
Yeah.
And you probably had a go at Selena Scott's sex life.
Well, and we only said she'd enjoyed some smoked salmon down by a loch in Lomond. That was all.
A Loch in Lomond.
There was only one Loch in Lomond. Yeah.
I don't know what.
Can't remember what it's called.
The Queen.
No, the answer is
has someone complained? Are they all complained?
Only one of them was thrown out, which was Julia Carling. The rest of them were all.
So you lost three, and Julia Carling.
Oh, we didn't lose.
You beat
three.
Julia Carling.
We had three adjudications against us, which we tried to resist.
Sounds like 3-1 down to me.
Admittedly, we were left in a slightly vulnerable position.
You accepted the rulings, obviously, Piers.
Of course
didn't
we
you?
Did, yeah.
As a paid-up member of the Press Complaints Commission, you said, fine, it's a fair cop.
Exactly.
Mm.
What are you getting at it?
No, just checking you hadn't been vindictive
no,
about
we had
it
not.
Afterwards.
And no way would I be vindictive unless it was Rupert Addison.
Oh.
Well, he's the one that brought a case against you, and then you sent...
No, he thinks we've got a vendetta against him.
Which you have.
The one that you sent your photographers to the south of France to photograph him. That Ritz Allison, is that the one? Just because he took a court case against
you. We have a vendetta against his party. There's nothing wrong with that.
But you left him alone until he brought a case against you.
No, he's always bringing cases against it. He loves it.
Well, let's not fall out over this. Have we got the points?
The truth is, Julia Carling is the only one who was unsuccessful in a Press Complaints Commission complaint against...
Because they adjudicated that she'd invaded her own privacy.
They said that unlike Earl Spencer, for instance, who has sold his family photos to Hello magazine repeatedly for lots of money, she had put herself into the public eye. It was deemed that Earl Spencer was entitled to privacy because, presumably, he's...
Well, his wife was entitled to receive treatment in hospital without being photographed, was the ruling the basis.
That was part of the ruling, yeah. That was the part I'd concede.
But your proprietor agreed with the PCC, didn't he?
He did, yes.
You sort of got rather bollocked by Murdoch, didn't you?
Rather. I got severely bollocked, yeah.
Did he?
Were you then sacked?
You're now...
Sacked, did you say?
Were you sacked?
That's a very serious thing to say on television.
Did you get sacked?
I didn't get sacked.
You promoted.
I'm glad you said it, because that's going to help pay for the holiday, thanks.
I can just imagine a jury finding for the editor of the News of the World.
It's almost like finding for the editor of Private Eye, isn't it? Mm. By the way, Ian, you know where you live?
Yeah.
You're about to get a new neighbour.
You?
Happy New Year.
Actually, next door neighbours are you going to be?
He'll be within long lens, I can assure you.
Is that a photographer?
He's a charmer, isn't he?
That's a man on a bicycle.
That's the Transport Secretary, who missed his train. This is Railtrack, where we've sold off the rail industry.
Is that the Daily Mirror?
Yes, exactly.
I use the collective we as in you and I. In.
Oh, right.
Okay.
Right.
And we've all made lots of money, all those who invested in it, which I didn't, but I presume a capitalist like Ian would have done. And at the end of the day...
Have you two met before somewhere? And you're...
You're very left-wing for a man who used to edit the News of the World.
He's very left-wing for a man who currently edits the Daily Mirror.
I want to go on, but the tragedy is that the poor girl that won had a terrible arthritic attack moments before she went on stage.
Piers, this is a comedy news quiz. arthritis doesn't normally feature in that. But a lot of sad stories that don't get on.
Well, you're here, Clive. Yeah. Mm.
but you won't be back.
No, your clue is Little Willie. No.
It's William Waldegrave.
Ian Hislop.
We've resorted to genital insult, have we? You and Paula Yates.
Well,
the cream of the nation's wits.
Ever a man of my word. Piers, your four unlikely companions are Rupert Allison, Sting, a koala bear, Jeffrey Clements, leader of the Natural Law Party.
Is the answer jam?
Not in so many words.
Because last week Eddie Izzard said everybody roared with laughter. It was hilarious. I just thought I'd say.
But people like him.
Yeah. Oh, sorry.
I will continue what I was going to say, but I was going to remind everyone that the PCC castigated the Daily Mirror in March for giving away the whereabouts of Robbie Coltrane's house, saying in some cases the publication of an individual's address might create a potential risk to that person. The Mirror apologised for any stress caused in a press statement issued by their editor, Piers Morgan, of 13 Woodcut Drive, Chigwell.
Actually, can I just say that they actually they rejected that complaint?
Did they?
By Robbie Coltrane. So you're entirely wrong to use that against me.
Oh, yeah, but they did say that...
I just thought I'd say that, in case the viewers got the wrong idea by this vindictive attack on me, personally. Carry on.
You're feeling a bit vulnerable.
You're invading my privacy, and I'd rather you left me alone.
You've stepped into the public eye now, Piers. You were elected to come on this programme. You've got to take it.
Charged with lying, hasn't he?
Yes.
With falsifying with the big bus with the figure outside that was something like £320 billion a week goes through Europe or something like that.
So we'll have to be careful, or they'll cut this out, and I don't want anyone to spoil the fun of thinking Boris is going to go to jail for life. So, at the moment, we're just at the preliminary hearing stage.
Oh, right, OK.
About whether, when he was a public official, he was telling lies and therefore abusing his office. It should be an interesting trial.
I mean, very similar to putting the Pope on trial and saying, are you a Catholic? he was sacked from then sacked from sacked by his own reprimanded
Ian,
yes.
We're not allowed to say anything that might prejudice the case.
Well, that's absolutely fair enough, because I would like him to have a fair trial with a desirable result of him being imprisoned forever.
Without wishing to prejudice the outcome of the case?
No, because we mustn't do that. I'm not saying he's guilty.
Would you like to see Boris Johnson?
Let's deal with your arguments. One of them is on the side of this bus. We send 350 million to Europe. We don't, and you know we don't. No, we don't. You know we don't. Admit that that figure is grotesquely misleading at best.
I went.
The true figure is 161 million, correct?
No, the true figure is 350 million.
In net terms, the real figure is 161.
If you take out the abatement and the money that comes back, the UK money that comes back via Brussels, the figure is obviously lower.
Matt Lucas is so good.
So where did David Cameron decide to start pumping himself up?
Where
did this happen? Yes. I mean, geographically, where?
Was it in the Ghoul area?
He was visiting the Institute of Chartered Accountants.
Oh, yes, I see.
That's a really pumped up kind of place.
Exactly right. Yeah, do you want to have a little look at this?
Yeah.
And if I'm getting lively about it, it's because I feel bloody lively about it. And if you think I'm going to roll over in the next 10 days and let Ed Miliband and Alex Salmond rack that, you've got another thing coming. Taking a risk, having a punt, having a go. That pumps me up.
I think that passes for hysteria amongst the accountants. Yeah. As well as being bloody lively and pumped up, what else is David Cameron going to do?
He's not going to put up taxes.
He's not going to put up taxes.
It's more than that,
but
though,
how is he going to ensure
he's going
that
to pass
by an act of parliament
to stop people like himself putting up taxes? It's the most pathetic gesture I've ever seen. Saying, look, I can't be trusted not to just whack up income tax as soon as I get in, so I'm going to pass a law to stop me. Income tax, VAT and national insurance.
Yeah.
You know, in any government that comes in, historically, the first thing they do is they put up taxes, because they have to. And it's the only year you can do it where you're not worried about the election. So taxes will go up. He'll have to find some other ones. Or break the law and be arrested. Or maybe he knows he's not getting in anyway. Oh, the Kent police.
George Osborne was very good on this in 2009. Because Brown was talking about passing legislation.
Yeah, Gordon Brown outlawed child poverty.
Yeah.
Gone. Thank God for that. Don't have to worry about that anymore. It's against the law. No, it's finished.
The low point of the media coverage this week, I think, was the analysis of Samantha Cameron's feet.
In
various newspapers where there was a shot of her with her shoes off and there were big close-ups and all the experts were coming in to describe.
There's thought of a slight yellowing of the
definitely
toenails.
Definitely a yellowing and could have been how caused... high heels were damaging her feet.
Was it in the Daily Mail? Was it saying Labour poisons Sam's feet?
which football team does David Cameron support?
Aston Villa.
Mm. Well, he doesn't really know, does he? And he claimed to be an Aston Villa supporter, but then he said this in a speech.
Where you can support Man United, the Windies and Team GB all at the same time. Of course, I'd rather you supported West Ham.
He seemed to realise he'd said the wrong thing.
How did he explain his mistake?
I don't support West Ham or Aston Villa. I'm no interested in football. We played rugger where I come from. But a lot of people watch football, so I pretended to have an interest in it in order to gain their votes.
Oh, it's time now for the missing words round, which this week features as its guest publication, Ratitude. The magazine of the North of England Rat Society. For northerners who don't find pigeons dirty enough. And we start with... Putin is what, says author?
Great bloke and I want to live.
Yeah.
Is it gay?
The answer is latently gay, says author. A new biography of Vladimir Putin speculates that he might be latently gay. biographer is not the first to make this claim. The idea that President Putin is lately has been put forward by a number of recently deceased psychologists. Next, chimps take what?
Is it the fucking piss?
The answer is chimps take their owners to court.
No, they don't.
This is the story of a court case in New York in which four chimpanzees are seeking to be recognised as humans. The complexities of the chimpanzees' case have left legal experts scratching their heads, rubbing their asses on ropes and eating things from behind each other's ears. Next, from a rat PR point of view, what was very negative?
The bubonic plague.
No, it's the name Red-Eyed Devil. Next, Chinese girl had what in her ear?
British Prime Minister talking patronisingly. Got a flower in her head.
It was a fully grown dandelion. A doctor tried to remove it by blowing. But all that happened was he found out it was 3 o'clock.
Yeah, no, it was extraordinary. I mean, I thought it'd be terribly boring, like most conference speeches, but it was just fabulous. And I know a lot of people who are probably nicer than me felt very sorry for her. But I thought it was very, very funny.
It's a bad sign when a cough suite goes down better than you do.
She coughed so much, it felt like she was going to start coughing insects. Like an actual horror film.
But it's that moment when you're talking to someone who doesn't really believe what they're saying, and they're saying, yes, I'm really the person for the job. And everything's going very...
Coughing does not do well for female politicians. Her and Hillary Clinton, yeah. Their colds have destroyed them.
Well, Ian Duncan Smith used to cough a lot. Mm. Do you remember? He was another successful Tory... leader.
he never had it that bad, though.
No, you don't think so?
No, it's a sort of much lower level cough based problem. Theresa May took it to, I mean, she weaponized. That was quite incredible. I can't believe you didn't feel any sympathy for her at all. Not even a scintilla.
Oh dear.
I did.
I think I'm coming across as a bad person.
It was awful. I only felt sorry for her because of Boris. I feel that she's. That was such a bad day that it was almost a win for Boris, and I feel that's the only... So I feel like I hate him so much that you want her to have a better gig, you know? Why don't she sack Boris?
She can't, can she, sack Boris?
Why?
Because if she sacks him, he gets to walk away from Brexit while simultaneously being able to claim that if he'd stayed in the government, it all would have gone much better than it's clearly going to go.
You know, she can't allow him the pleasure. It's like, you know, he's essentially an arsonist who wants to come back dressed as a fireman.
Yes. Yes.
Where's the fire?
There was one of her, so, I mean, she's been accused of being robotic, so one of the Conservative backbenchers today was making the rounds of the TV studio saying she's made of very strong metal, which I thought was...
Well, people say that at a certain point a Prime Minister runs out of luck. Mm. It just happens to you when everything's going wrong.
Yeah. It's like the end. It's like the complete end. She's not so much as occupying the office of Prime Minister, it's haunting it.
I mean, again, it's difficult to make up, but the first letter is F, so it's an F off.
An F off. 15% of respondents to a YouGov poll said that the speech had gone well. 15, which is, there's no way that could just be the cabinet. 15% of people. 15% of people watched that and thought, yes, that's gone rather well. Which makes you wonder what it would take to lower that number from 15%. She could have stood there and melted like the witch at the end of The Wizard of Oz. She said 12% think it went rather well. She's a puddle on the floor. 10% still think it's gone rather well. It's 15%.
Are you sure that isn't just members of the Labour Party?
What lie did Boris Johnson tell Robert Peston?
Was this the 350 million again?
Linked.
On the NHS?
Linked. Yeah.
Did he say it would be reconsidered? Yeah.
He said it was in the manifesto.
Yeah.
Did she say it at the manifesto launch?
No. Not only did he lie, but he actually cheated as well. Because he looked at Peston's notes in the hope of finding out what the question was going to be, and he was caught.
I didn't know what cheating you were referring to there.
You've suddenly adopted the character of a northern housewife.
Oh!
Have you heard about... Well, no surprise to me. He was rinsing out his own gloves last Saturday.
We haven't talked about Labour very much, so to head off any accusations of bias...
Are you leaving now to be replaced? The next round will be hosted by Michael Portillo. Come on, we can have a train round.
When it comes to Labour's manifesto promises, how did Shadow Foreign Secretary Emily Thornberry muddy the waters?
Was this Trident?
Yep.
She said there'd be a review, and the review might include scrapping it. Was that the problem?
And do you know who contradicted her and said it was Labour's policy to keep Trident?
Shadow Defence?
The Shadow Defence Secretary, that's right. This was Nia Griffiths, the Shadow Defence Secretary. Emily is not the Shadow Defence Secretary I am.
You're doing it again!
I
don't know what that man was. She was in the pub on Saturday, but it wasn't her husband, I'll tell you that much. I know full well he's got a job in Peterborough.
Has anything happened?
Well, she's been to Brussels and everything
that
has changed.
Every week.
People say, oh, we missed Brexit Day, March the 29th. It's not happened. But if you listen to what they're saying in Brussels, they're saying, well, actually, we might give you another extension and we can still have a Brexit Day. And there are some people there who think, well, let's have it every year, every single March the 29th. Theresa May or somebody like her will trot off to Brussels and say, we'll have another 12-month extension.
Yeah.
And Brexit will still definitely be happening, but we'll just sort of...
Yeah, you know. And we could tell everyone we've left... And then just not mention it again.
Exactly. But Halloween, you know, is the next cut-off.
Do you think that was a joke by the Europeans?
I think it was a joke. But you've got Tory MPs going around saying, ah, well, we must dress up as something for Halloween, you know.
How about as MPs?
Well...
That's the former Prime Minister.
That's the 1922 committee. Yeah. Yeah.
That's the Queen. No, that's Andrea Leadsom. Oh, God.
At time of recording, who's Prime Minister?
Boris Johnson.
It is currently Theresa May.
Oh, right, of course.
Yeah, but how bad have things got for Theresa May?
There's been another cabinet revolt. She won't even see her main ministers. She's now got a cabinet of two, herself and her husband. even he's walking out. Everyone's gone. Andrea Leadsom's gone, you saw there.
Do you know what number Andrea Leadsom is on the resignation list under Theresa May? How many have gone?
36.
She's the 36th minister. There's a graph from the BBC.
A graph on a comedy show? This is the
This is a graph of ministerial resignations before Theresa May, and here it is with Theresa May on it.
This is Theresa May's plan to end the Brexit deadlock. According to the Sunday Times, Philip May's emphasis has shifted to hoping his wife can escape from number 10 with dignity. Sorry, Phil, but however she finally goes, Colonel Gaddafi left with more dignity.
Quite right.
Brexit has clearly put a strain on Theresa May's marriage, but there's no way they'll split up, as Philip May knows negotiating a divorce deal would take years, and he'd need the support of Jeremy Corbyn. According to The Telegraph, MPs are sitting in the longest parliamentary session since the English Civil War. Or, as future historians will call it, English Civil War I.
The director of the Paris Archdiocese, Philippe de Couvreville, told The Times, "We tend to wait for things to become catastrophic before we take care of them." To which Theresa May replied, "Oh, you too."
If you really want to know what the members of the cabinet are thinking, you have to watch Newsnight.
Yes.
And listen to Nicholas Watt.
I said to one cabinet minister, why is the Prime Minister holding a vote when she's pretty sure that she's going to lose? And using very strong language, this cabinet minister said to me, fuck knows, I'm past caring, it's like the living dead in here. Oh.
Following a tense meeting of the 1922 committee, evidence emerges as to who ate Sir Graham Brady's donut. Rees-Mogg was obviously very appalled by all this, but he does have his Facebook supporters group to boost his morale. Have you seen his Facebook?
No, well, it's actually been outlawed because it's based in Broadmoor.
Let's have a look at this illuminating forum. Just for interest's sake, are there any young folk on this site? Yes, I'm 55.
has Boris done for the second time in 6 months?
Nothing.
Gone home in the same direction?
Finally, 72-year-old becomes the oldest competitor in what?
Young Conservatives leadership.
So this is the news that scientists have released the first ever picture of a black hole.
Theresa May is very excited about this because it's a whole new entity out there with which we might do a trade deal in due course. And she's just glad there's another despairing vortex sucking in all human life and light from which there is no escape.
So as the good ship Theresa sinks slowly beneath the waves, who are the latest Tories to thrust themselves forward?
Oh, I don't like that expression. I don't think anybody in the Tory party can thrust. I don't think they've got their own hips.
I think everyone who's been elected ever as a Tory thinks I could do a better job than Theresa May. I mean, they're not wrong.
I think you have to have a photo shoot in your kitchen to get into the race.
Yes. This is James Brokenshire. Here he is, with his Meg.
Oh, that is a lovely
That's
kitchen.
Him. I know. And he's Count got... the ovens, Tom. Count the ovens.
Four... Four ovens?
That we know of. There could be more.
There could be more that come...
It was George Eustace who quit as farming minister in February. So let's see a colleague in the Scottish Parliament's alarmingly frank assessment of him.
I personally have met with Andrea Leadison and I've had two meetings with George Eustace.
Evidence emerges to show why agreeing even the most basic of trade deals has taken Liam Fox such a long time. There's Gavin Williamson walking, which is something he's not denying.
And that's a brilliant bit of dramatised leaking.
Yeah. Oh, Helen Mirren's stuck for work. She's... Gavin Williamson has been fired for allegedly leaking secrets, but he swears on his children's life that it wasn't him. And he has been fired by Theresa May, which is unusual because she loves not firing people. Mm. She's a big fan of just letting people stay, Chris Grayling.
Normally, you know, if you sacked your defence secretary, it would be three volumes of a history book. But with this government, yeah, all right, he's gone.
Theresa May seems so definite that he did it that I'm assuming he didn't.
This is the news that Gavin Williamson has been sacked as Secretary of State for Defense over the Huawei leak. As The Guardian put it, Williamson is the first cabinet minister to go for a leak since 1986. How has Williamson responded?
He accused her of ingratitude. He said, I've saved your career twice, as though anyone's going to be grateful for that.
Yeah, that does mean prison, I think. He admits to that.
I think maybe he did it, he just didn't realise. Because he seems very adamant that he did not do it. Yeah. If you're going to swear on your children's life, that's...
Yeah, I don't think we should hold him to that.
But he said it, Andy. Oh. He said it. Well, it's fine, though. He doesn't have any kids. There you go.
Not anymore.
Or he won't.
Johnny, yeah. You were in the army.
Yeah.
You sit on that committee. Is this a good idea?
No, I mean, it doesn't sound great, but the people who know this stuff seem to think it's all right, but, you know...
You don't sound totally lukewarm, even.
my political vim and vigour is on its last legs, I think. Much like the government.
The rest of the...
Theresa Mayhem in a £900 coat. There she is, flying off to Brussels to be told what to do and say and think. The real Prime Minister.
On the left.
The traitor's kiss. The Politburo, or is that Bexley Heath Council? And a man on a bike.
What are the rival camps calling Jeremy Hunt?
Sounds like.
I got it. Apparently, Jeremy Hunt is called Theresa in trousers, or tit for short. Did you see how Liz Truss dealt with the question on LBC?
No, but I can't wait.
What do you think of having another EU referendum?
A very, very, very bad idea.
But people can change their minds, can't they?
But they were told in the referendum in 2016 that their vote would be implemented, and the reality is the vote needs to be implemented.
But what about the people who've changed their minds between then and now?
I don't think people have changed their minds. Everyone I speak to
I have, that's true.
Who are you backing in the Conservative leadership election?
There isn't one. There isn't a Conservative leadership
Should there be one in the near future, if that's something we could
I don't know if that's going to happen.
What are they doing running around trying to get each other's votes, then?
You're not going to believe this, but some of my colleagues are slightly more fixated with their own careers than what's going on in Brexit. I know.
Now, that is shocking.
Right. absolute shock. So, yeah, some people are running around trying to be Prime Minister at a time of national crisis.
Including Mrs May.
Theresa May still have support among the grassroots outside the Westminster bubble. How did she get on in Wales this week?
She got heckled.
Yes, she did, didn't she?
Yep, she made a speech to local party activists and everything went well for the first 5 seconds. Then...
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, and...
Why don't you resign?
Look at the top pledge on the top. We will invade Iraq against the wishes of the people of Britain.
Yeah, but it was Miliband who stopped the invasion into Syria. That's something for him, isn't it? I haven't heard you say much about that.
No, because I'm more interested in the previous one, which you were involved in.
And we made it clear that's so. We made a mistake. There's no doubt about that. But give Miliband the credit for stopping us doing the same thing with Syria.
Okay,
because Cameron was about to get to do it with the Americans.
Yeah, no, I have no problem with that. No, Obama
took
the
hit. You just don't work about it or talk about it. Anyway, that's the difference between us.
Yeah.
Should we start again?
But you say the manifesto will only just come out, so the candidate can't be expected to know what's in it. Is the manifesto meant to be a massive surprise to Labour candidates?
No, but when you get... Well, in our party, you have to get it through the National Executive and we have a policy making for the manifesto. You don't know necessarily what's coming through. I think some great things have come through, particularly when we're dealing with the Leveson report and what are we going to do about making the press more accountable.
Yes, you're
That's quite important.
You're going to legislate, aren't you?
What we said about that, we will carry out what Leveson said. We wait to see the press...
Leveson said nothing about a royal charter. He didn't mention it.
I would have thought you as a journalist might find that's an important point.
No, as a journalist, it's an unimportant point.
Oh, blimey, in private eye, you're sued every day, for God's sake, for what you say about people.
No, we're not. And certainly
Johnny.
Not about you. I know you've got problems with the press and your private life, John.
I think the last time you raised it, you got the same move. Why don't you be more specific and say it? Usually straightforward in private eye. What's your complaint?
OK, you're very, very unhappy about the press's intrusion into your private life, because they revealed
you
were
having an
affair
with Tracy
Temple.
No, I've never complained about it at all.
And it was very embarrassing for you.
No, it wasn't.
Got it. It wasn't embarrassing.
No, I made a mistake. I owned up to it publicly, and I was waiting for this one
you
to come
from you.
You
didn't own up to it publicly. You were revealed
as
doing
it.
Hey.
I've got an idea. Why don't you two find a room? And whoever comes out alive is the winner.
I don't think there's any doubt about that.
That was a death stare. He gave me a death stare.
It depends who's ordering the room service, I suppose, doesn't it, John?
What bit did the BBC get wrong?
This idea. So I run a company that trains veterans to go into cyber employment.
Yeah.
And four companies away from that, there's a company that's gone bust.
Yeah, it's not many companies. It's quite a big company. Four people being arrested. Big story.
It's a big story, but it's got
but
you
never,
to do with me.
You never...
Well, of course not. Not that I have anything to do with
financial products. Your £85,000 salary?
Yes, and it was provided through business in that company that company generated. That
how does training
to do
veterans
us, yeah.
make enough money to earn you 85
grand? Because if you train them in cyber security, And they have specialist skills. They go into FTSE 100 companies and they earn quite a lot of money in cybersecurity. I sound like a right bastard, don't I, doing this whole sort of veterans employment thing?
No, it's not the veterans bit. It's the £85,000 yeah. for a four-hour yeah. job.
I know. I know what you're thinking, because you're
I'm thinking, why don't you do it for free?
I know, because you get 20 grand for 2 hours tonight, don't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, but the people who've lost money out of this company yeah. are very cross with you. It's about your behaviour and the fact that you didn't know. And didn't ask, as a non-executive director, where does the money come from for the
I did
company?
Ask where it came from, and it came from the business that's generated by the business that we do.
They were providing the money that kept your company going.
No, they
you
didn't.
Were a non-executive.
No, they didn't. That's why the BBC are being sued for libel, because no money went from that company into Crucial Academy.
But it did, though.
OK, well, you can keep saying that, but it really yeah. didn't. It
no,
still
no, no,
didn't.
I'm just saying the chain...
This is one for Judge Rinder, I think.
Yeah. yeah. I'm merely trying to establish the facts. You say you're going to sue the BBC for reporting a story that everybody else has run, and you say that's not how the money got there.
I am absolutely sure that not a single penny has come from LCF and gone into Crucial Academy. If it has,
well,
I would leave.
It hasn't gone directly in. It's gone in through a series
no,
of other companies.
No, directly or indirectly. If it had, I would leave. Many
all
more?
Right. Well, we'll see what happens.
This is like all of my Christmas dinners with my family. Anne
Widdicombe. Yeah. I'm sorry, David, it's a big story. Four people were arrested, and I know you think that your political enemies have smeared you with this story, but
no,
it
I don't.
Is there.
No, I don't.
It's in the news.
No, I don't think that. I don't think they have smeared me with this story.
But you have accused the Deputy Chief Whip of trying to dig up dirt.
The Deputy Chief Whip has decided to go and ask friends of mine that I served with in the military whether or not things in my book were correct, and... Obviously, I found out, wasn't overly pleased. That book was signed off by the parents of individuals who were killed in that war and who fought with me and my soldiers, but obviously not good enough for the Deputy Chief Whip. And when I confronted him about it, he claimed that was his job, to kick the tyres. And when I spoke to my friend, who he had actually spoken to, he hadn't done anything like that at all. He'd tried to get some dirt and blackmail me to vote for the Prime Minister's deal in January.
That's why they did it, to try and force your vote?
Yeah.
Right.
Nice place, politics.
Yeah, it sounds great.
Yeah, why did I sign up?
Why did you?
Yeah.
Like Anne Widdicombe, remember her?
Look at the top pledge on the top. We will invade Iraq against the wishes of the people of Britain.
Yeah, but it was Miliband who stopped the invasion into Syria. That's something for him, isn't it? I haven't heard you say much about that.
No, because I'm more interested in the previous one, which
well,
you
we were
involved
wrong.
In.
And we made it clear that so. We made a mistake. There's no doubt about that. But give Miliband the credit for stopping us doing the same thing with Syria.
Okay,
because Cameron was about to get to do it with the Americans.
Yeah, no, I have no problem with that. And Obama
you just
took,
don't
took
work about it or talk about it. Anyway, that's the difference between us.
Yeah.
Should we start again?
But you say the manifesto would only just come out, so the candidate can't be expected to know what's in it. Is the manifesto meant to be a massive surprise to Labour candidates?
No, but when you get... Well, in our party, you have to get it through the National Executive and we have a policy-making for the manifesto. You don't know necessarily what's coming through. I think some great things have come through, particularly when we're dealing with the Leveson report and what are we going to do about making the press more accountable.
Yes, you're
that's quite important.
You're going to legislate, aren't you?
What we said about that, we will carry out what Leveson said. We wait to see the press...
Leveson said nothing about a royal charter. He didn't mention it.
I would have thought you as a journalist might find that's an important point.
No, as a journalist, it's an unimportant point.
Oh, blimey, you're blimey. In private eye, you're sued every day, for God's sake, for what you say about people.
No, we're not. And
this
certainly
is Johnny.
Not about you. I know you've got problems with the press and your private life, John.
I think the last time you raised it, you got the same move. Why don't you be more specific and say it? Usually straightforward in private eye. What's your complaint?
OK, you're very, very unhappy about the press's intrusion into your private life, because
no,
they revealed
no,
you were having an affair
No, never complained about
Tracy
it
Temple,
at all.
And it was very embarrassing for you.
No, it wasn't.
Got it. It wasn't embarrassing.
No, I made a mistake. I owned up to it publicly, and I was waiting for this one
you
to come
You didn't own up to it publicly. You were revealed
I've
as doing
it.
I've
got an idea.
Hey.
I've got an idea.
I did a it at the Labour conference?
Didn't you watch
that? You two find a room, and whoever comes out alive is the winner.
I don't think there's any doubt about that.
It depends who's ordering the room service, I suppose, doesn't it, John?
This is like a terrible family Christmas.
Yeah. Now, that really is enough about the government's bad week. Oh, no, sorry. Andy Coulson. Where did he unexpectedly find himself this week?
In the back of a cop car heading to Scotland.
Mm. Mm. Because?
Because they want to have a word.
I had absolutely no idea that you were a gangster.
Andy Coulson.
He's been arrested for perjury.
Yes.
During a trial where someone else was on trial for perjury.
Yes.
While he was actually working for the Prime Minister, which is pretty shocking. Are you shocked, Alistair?
I'm shocked.
You. I'm glad you're shocked, because, you know, some of the people that this government have been hanging about with, Rebecca Brooks... Know her at all?
I do.
Were you shocked when she
shocked.
Was arrested?
I've been shocked by lots of things, Ian.
He's been charged, though. Not just arrested, yeah. He's been charged.
He's been charged.
Which is why Ian's being so careful.
Yeah.
About have we got Andy Coulson, not about me.
Well, they haven't charged you yet.
Is it hot in here?
In case anyone thinks I'm being gratuitous, I know that Alistair is going to be reasonable tonight because he told Leveson, I am robust, but I'm not a bully. So no matter what anyone says, you're going to be really reasonable.
Tonight? No.
That's good, though, to remember. Like, if your kid gets caught, like, kicking a fat kid, just go, no, he's not a bully, just robust. He's robust.
It probably seemed like a good idea when you said yes.
What bit did the BBC get wrong?
This idea. So I run a company that trains veterans to go into cyber employment.
Yeah.
And four companies away from that, there's a company that's gone bust.
Yeah, it's not many companies. It's quite a big company. Four people being arrested. Big story.
It's a big story, but it's got
but
nothing
never,
to do with me.
But you never...
Well, of course not. Why would I have anything to do with
financial products? Not
provided
your £85,000 salary?
Yes, and it was provided through business in that company that company generated. That
how does training veterans make enough money to earn you £85,000?
Because if you train them in cyber security... and they have specialist skills, they go into FTSE 100 companies and they earn quite a lot of money in cybersecurity. I sound like a right bastard, don't I, doing this whole sort of veterans employment thing?
No, it's not the veterans bit, it's the £85,000 for a four-hour job.
I know what you're thinking, because you're thinking...
I'm thinking, why don't you do it for free?
I know, because you get 20 grand for 2 hours tonight, don't you?
Yeah, but the people who've lost money out of this company are very cross with you. It's about your behaviour and the fact that you didn't know. And didn't ask, as a non-executive director, where does the money come from for this
company?
I did
ask where it came from, and it came from the business that's generated by the business that we do.
They were providing the money that kept your company going.
No, they
didn't. You were a non-exec.
No, they didn't. That's why the BBC are being sued for libel, because no money went from that company into Crucial Academy.
But it did, though.
OK, well, you can keep saying that, but it really didn't.
No, I'm just saying the chain...
This is one for Judge Rinder, I think.
Yeah. I'm merely trying to establish the facts. You say you're going to sue the BBC for reporting a story that everybody else has run, and you say that's not how the money got there.
I am absolutely sure that not a single penny has come from LCF and gone into Crucial Academy. If it has,
well,
I would leave.
It hasn't gone directly in. It's gone in through a series of
no,
other companies.
Directly or indirectly. If it had, I would leave. Many
all
more?
Right, well, we'll see what happens.
This is like all of my Christmas dinners with my family. Anne Widdicombe.
Yeah. I'm I'm sorry, David, it's a big story. Four people were arrested, and I know you think that your political enemies have smeared you with this story, but
no,
it
I don't.
Is there.
No, I don't.
It's in the news.
No, I don't think that. I don't think they have smeared me with this story.
But you have accused the Deputy Chief Whip of trying to dig up dirt.
The Deputy Chief Whip has decided to go and ask friends of mine that I served with in the military whether or not things in my book were correct, and... obviously, I found out, wasn't overly pleased. That book was signed off by the parents of individuals who were killed in that war and who fought with me and my soldiers, but obviously not good enough for the Deputy Chief Whip. And when I confronted him about it, he claimed that was his job, to kick the tyres. And when I spoke to my friend, who he had actually spoken to, he hadn't done anything like that at all. He'd tried to get some dirt and blackmail me to vote for the Prime Minister's deal in January.
That's why they did it, to try and force your vote?
Yeah.
Right.
Nice place, politics.
Yeah, it sounds great.
Yeah, why did I sign up?
Why did you?
Yeah.
Like Anne Widdecombe. Remember her?
Yeah, people wanting to vote.
Unmanageable turnout of 65%.
That's the Lib Dem votes being chucked in the river. Goodbye to you. Go and watch a film, one of your husbands. Hello, Gordon. Did you stay up for Lembit?
Oh.
It was. It's the most important thing that happened in the election.
Because?
It's quite funny.
Ladies and gentlemen, the great thing about losing my seat is I can actually take a fee for this now instead of getting this kind of abuse for nothing.
It is indeed the overwhelmingly indecisive outcome of the election. In fact, we only know one result for sure, don't we, Lembit?
Can we get on with this? I've actually got an appointment with the job centre in about half an
hour. They phoned earlier, they cancelled.
So, Paul, Ian, the old certainties are gone. It's time for unlikely alliances. Paul, could you ever find it in your heart to put your bitter rivalry to one side and form a coalition with Ian?
Yeah, all right.
Go on, then.
I've got a feeling you're going to win this week.
Can I say I've always wanted this?
Yeah.
I've argued for it for years. And any suggestion that I'm doing it as a matter of convenience is not true. I agree with Nick. Yes. Paul.
Do you want to do a rabble-rousing speech on behalf of our coalition?
I think what we offer is not them, basically. People are sick of you coming on here, making fun of the contestants, you know? Just because I'm having a bit of a hard time at the moment, lend us the price of a cup of tea, I'll give it back to you. I've got me Latin governor, I've got me harmonica, I can play that for you if you want. And I have.
No, I've got to find some change.
I have.
Are we witnessing a mental breakdown?
You do the singing and I'll do the playing.
Ritual is so... I mean, what are the benefits of joining this club? If that, I mean, what do you get? 10% off sports equipment? I mean, what's the great club that you have to stick your cock in a dead pig's mouth to become a member?
Ian, you used to be a member, didn't you?
There's a hesitation.
No, I wasn't a member. It says I was a member on Wikipedia.
That's what they all say.
Yeah, which is quite embarrassing, given I spent half the week with tabloid journalists ringing me up saying, have you...
placed your chap?
Clarkson in a...
Yeah.
receptacle. Anyway, no, I was not a member of the Piers Gaveston Society. I was a member of the Piers Morgans.
I won't ask what the ritual was to get into that club.
Did you know people who were, though? Is that the sort of thing they did?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, they threw...
Yes, no, no. Wow. Your final two words on the subject? Yes, no.
He asked me two questions. He said, did you know people who were there?
Yes.
And then he asked another question. So I said, yes, I did know people. Yes. No, I didn't, which is
is sort of my answer.
I thought I was the one that was going to get a hard time tonight, and it turns out Ian is. Right, yes, this is...
That it. We're going to just what? Leave it alone. Lord Ashcroft getting this amazing story into the public domain via the Daily Mail.
I don't think it's even a story. It's a fantasy.
It's an act of amazing revenge by the Mail in cohorts with Lord Ashcroft, which the whole country has decided to believe. Usually a story in the Daily Mail, peddled by a non-dom Tory peer who gave £8 million to the Tory party and is in a strop because he wasn't made Defence Secretary, would be laughed out of court. Well, it's not in court yet, but I was hoping it might get in. But no, we've all taken this seriously, and there's the grinning Lord Ashcroft, who, I mean, you know, if you want to talk about members inserted into, you know, the House of Lords, there he is. I mean, it's a disgraceful story. This man, Lord Ashcroft, who gave the Tories all this money, thought he could get himself into the cabinet, thought he could buy himself a cabinet post. And everybody's gone along with this, saying, oh, great, Lord Ashcroft. I mean, he's a non-dom. If we're doing prick jokes, let's have a condom joke. And if you want something disgusting the Prime Minister's done, I mean, you know, there's loads of it. Bedroom tax would be a good start. There's plenty of these things, and everyone goes around saying, oh, it's about a pig when he was 20. Well, how about being really appalling when he was 50?
Miller's resignation attracted the usual bunch of renter quotes. What we've seen is a Prime Minister who clearly is totally disconnected with how the voters in Britain feel about MPs' expenses. That was Nigel Farage. The same Nigel Farage who in 2009 revealed that as an MEP, he'd claimed in expenses £2 million of taxpayers' money.
And who was it? Who was it that brought up the issue of £2 million and me and you. Taxpayers' money? Dennis McShane.
Yeah, he's in jail, but you're not.
Yes, I had noticed that.
Good.
Yes, well, as a tax-funded MEP, Nigel Farage is an equal opportunities employer. Some of our money has gone to his wife and some to his mistress. Or have
well,
I got
I think that
wrong?
Is allegedly, don't you? That is allegedly.
We can set the record straight now.
Yeah, I think it is. I think you ought to say allegedly, quite honestly.
Can I say, as a member of the press, I think, you know, actors really are in need of a royal charter. I mean, that sort of allegation is pretty distressing. Right, is it true?
No, afraid not.
Not true at all?
Not true at all.
Any of the good bits?
Well,
there are good bits.
I'll tell you afterwards.
Right.
Well, let's have a look, shall we, at some of those revelations. Here is Nikki Sinclair, a former UKIP MEP, now representing the We Demand a Referendum Party in the European Parliament. Take a close look at the reaction of the translator in the bottom left corner of the screen.
Does Mr Farage think it's a fair use of taxpayers' money, namely his secretarial allowance, not only to employ his wife Kirsten, but his former mistress Annabel Fuller? Is this a responsible use of taxpayers' money, Mr Farage?
I would just say this to you, Chairman. This is somebody who hid under the cloak of parliamentary privilege to make those comments, and when asked to repeat them, publicly refused to do so.
Quite funny, though.
David Cameron was very rude about your people, wasn't he, Nigel?
Oh, he always is.
Yes, he said...
He can't help himself.
He can't help himself. He said
no,
they were
fruit
all fruitcakes and loonies.
And loonies, and yes. Worse. He said worse than that.
He did, right.
Extremists.
Extremists?
Yeah.
Shocking.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's time... I think it's time for a game of fruitcake or loony. OK, everyone, fingers on your buzzers. I'll show you some UKIP party members. You have to buzz in and tell me whether they're a fruitcake or a loony. Here's the first one.
I don't know who he is.
Ian.
I'm just guessing.
Yeah.
Fruitcake.
I'm afraid that's the wrong answer. He's a loony. He's a would-be UKIP councillor and loony John Sullivan, who wrote, regular physical exercise releases boys' tensions and thus avoided homosexuality. Which is quite right, Mr Sullivan, and that's why you'll never see a gay man down the gym.